In the following 25 minutes, I will give you a short insight on the so-called Arbeitsjuden, what is indeed a typical Nazi term, at the annihilation camp located in Kulmhof, as the Nazis named a little village called Helmno. At first, I would like to give a short information about that German annihilation camp and its structure of murdering Jews from the Wartegau region and the routine slave work performed by the different commandos. Second, I will concentrate on our knowledge of the everyday life of the imprisoned Jews, and I would like to end with a short view on the historiography about the camp. So, Kulmhof was the first Nazi death camp founded by the German perpetrators in the so-called Reichsgau Warteland, as the annexed Western Polish territories were named. In contrast to all other death camps in occupied Poland, in Kulmhof the idea came from the German civil administration. And all organizational and financial matters were conducted in the German Reichsstatthalterei in Posen. Here you can see the both leading men of organizational and financial matters concerning the death camp. So I'm talking about the picture for the interpreter. On the left, you see Dr. Herbert Mehlhorn, who was responsible for the central department within the Reichsstatthalterei, who had all the organizational matters to do concerning the final solution in that Wartegau region, and Friedrich Häusler, who was responsible for all financial matters for running a death camp. Both are absolutely unknown in Germany. Mehlhorn was never put to trial, and even Friedrich Häusler never was put to trial. Friedrich Häusler was the leader or the boss of a little German local labor department, and Dr. Herbert Mehlhorn became the lawyer of Mauser Werke, of a German weapon and munition firm in Baden-Württemberg, near Stuttgart. So, I'm going on with the text. As we know that a lease contract between the German Sonderkommando and the regional gardening office, the Bezirksgartenbauamt in Hohensalza, regarding the camp's bordering market garden was concluded on October the 1st in 1941, we can assume that in the late days of September in 1941, an idea of regional mass murder on Wartegau Jews found its precise location. And this is the contract where you can see from the 1st of October in 1941 to the 30th of September in 1942, this little estate around the annihilation camp was leased by the SS commando. So when this contract refers to the 1st of October in 1941, you can assume that in the second half of September in 1941, this idea found a precise location. After the arrival of about 35 to 50 members of the German Sonderkommando Lange that had long experiences in murdering inmates of the psychiatric hospitals in occupied Poland, and after the relocation of almost 100 policemen from Litzmannstadt, the German staff was completed. 8 Polish prisoners from the 4-7 in Poznan, who had been used as grave diggers for the Sonderkommando during its campaign against the mentally ill, now were used as auxiliaries and were transferred to Kulmhof. They built the high wooden fence around the dominating old mansion that served as a collecting point for the victims' clothing and belongings, as well as the center of mass murder in gas vans. Now, this is this little village with a view from the near side, this little river, and you can see the church. And right beside the church there was the mansion house, the house where the Jews were murdered during the first period of Kulmhof. Situated on a tributary river called Neer, Kulmhof was a rural village of some 250 inhabitants, about 40 little houses and 12 farmyards, which were managed by resettled ethnic German families from Volhynia. The village was connected with a narrow gauge railroad via the villa called Arnsdorf or Powiercie, with the small district capital called Wartbrücken or Kowo, adjoining the railroad Reichsbahn expressway from Posen to Warschau. Kulmhof laid along a country road from Wartbrücken to Eichstätt or Dombier, and there was only one crossroad to the villa called Ladau or Ladurus and Schuchung or Schuchhof. Schuchhof. The vacant mansion and the church were clearly visible in the village shape, separated by a little road sloping down to the river Neer. In the near vicinity, there was the school of Kulmhof. After 2 or 3 kilometers along the country road from Kulmhof to Wartbrücken or Kolo was a woodland known as the Rüschuchhof forests, and on the street's left side there began a thick pine wood forest with forest roads and glades within. So this is the situation in Kulmhof, a little village, and the number one is the site of the mansion, and the number two is the church. Number four, perhaps, is the school. Number five and number three and number nine are canteens, administration houses, location where the policemen lived, and so on and so on. And the street to Kowo leads to the Rüschuchhof forest. During the first period from December 1941 to April 1943, the following system of mass murder against the Jews of the Wartegau region established. At arrival in Kulmhof by several trucks, only one of them passed the gates of the wooden fence around the mansion and entered the yard before. The victims were ordered to descend and told by a member of the Sonderkommando dressed in a white coat that they would all now be transferred from here to various commitments to work, but before they had to take a shower and their clothes had to be disinfected. All this would be done in the premises of the house in front of them. Then the Jews took the outside stairs, entered the rooms and undressed, while some of Herbert Lange's Polish prisoners seemingly registered the individual's personal belongings. Then the naked victims were forced to enter the basement steps with a sign called to the bathrooms. When people were hesitating and halting, they were forced by gross ill-treatment for the first time. The cellar's corridor spanned over the complete length of the mansion and ended on a second stairway up. Up again, the victims stood on a platform. On that end, one of the three gas vans were maneuvered. The shouting and beating German policemen and the badly lit corridor caused panic, and the Jews went quickly along the way, seeing the daylight and the staircase on the end, barely apprehending what was going on with them. So in effect, the victims hastened into the gas van's platform and the rear doors were closed. This is the rear side from the mansion house. It's a pre-war photo. There are no photos from this house during the time of the operation of the Kulmhof annihilation camp. Then the movable tailpipe was screwed on the lorry's bottom and the motor was started. The Jews were murdered by the carbon monoxide in the exhaust fume on the 15-minute running van engine. The battering and screaming was plainly audible. The tailpipe again was connected to the exhaust pipe, and the van drove to the forest camp where the corpses were buried in large mass graves. When in spring the corpses began to decay and sapped into the groundwater, the bodies were exhumed and burned in improvised furnaces under the supervision of the SS-Standartenführer Paul Blobel's Sonderkommando 1005, as we heard today in the morning. This period of mass murder ended in April 1943 when the Sonderkommando under the authority of Hans Bultmann had an official retirement by Reichsstatthalter Kreiser and was transferred to Serbia as part of the SS Division Prinz Eugen. But before, the Sonderkommando detonated the mansion, obliterating all traces of mass murder, cremating and burning the bodies, leveling the ground and planting forests. This is the view from today. You can still see the fundaments of the mansion, and on the other side of the little street, the church. These circumstances of detonating and tracing, obliterating all traces of mass murder, these circumstances clearly show that Kulmhof as an extermination site should never come into practice again. But it was the debate over the fate of the Jews in Litzmannstadt ghetto during the next month of 1943 to February 1944, which caused the improvised reopening of Kulmhof's extermination camp. When Bultmann and the remaining men of his Sonderkommando came back to Kulmhof together with some Gestapo members of an effacing and burning commando and new order policemen from Litzmannstadt, new work practices of mass murder had to be created. Now, the mansion yard was fenced with barbed wire. The former granary building beside the destroyed mansion was used as prison and working place for the Jews, whereas Hans Bibo from the German ghetto administration in Litzmannstadt organized a huge tent of 20 meters to 60 meters in Leipzig for stocking the clothes and belongings of the victims. The forest camp now served as the killing center where Jews had to undress in two wooden barracks. Again, they were forced through a corridor into the gas van, and the truck drove slowly to the furnaces where the Jews were burned. During the first period of operation, more than 145,000 Jews and about 4,300 gypsies from Litzmannstadt ghetto were murdered. During the second short period between June the 23rd and July the 14th, over 7,000 Jews from Litzmannstadt ghetto were gassed in the forest camp. The Jewish slave workers served as Arbeitsjuden. The Jewish slave workers served as Arbeitsjuden during both periods. They were a group of around 80 men who had been selected after arrival. They were divided into two different commandos, the Schlosskommando and the Waldkommando. One can easily imagine their daily involvement into the German murderous routine. The Schlosskommando had to clean the undressing rooms, throwing the clothes out of the windows on the mansion's rear side. They had to separate and subdivide all things, to search after valuables as gold and money, and to stock all things in the granary building. From time to time, they were selected to die and shot in the forest camp. The Waldkommando Jews were driven to the Ruschuchow forest every morning and had to dig the long pits. They had to remove the corpses from the van. They had to probe the bodies for jewelry. They had to pile them into the graves, and they cleaned the inside of the vans. Later on, they had to keep the furnaces fire burning and to crush the bones with flails. Although the Schlosskommando Jews worked while at the same time frightened Jews were maltreated, it seems that they had a little better fate because they could not be shot or beaten to death whenever a German felt like it. The Jews forced into the Waldkommando were victims of the guards' good or bad mood, and we know of several deadly games to which the German Gestapo men abused them, as for example, as living targets. Moreover, it was very dangerous to light the ovens or to work with typhus-infected corpses like the one of the gypsies who were sent to death from Litzmannstadt ghetto at the beginning of 1942. We know several names of Jewish forced workers in both commandos who decided for suicide because they knew their forthcoming fate, had buried their relatives, and could not stand their unimaginable misery. Historians know these situations in which Jews of Sonderkommandos not only were part of the murderous German killing routine, but also were outlawed and victims of sadistic varieties. But when we compare the situation and reflect about the camp of Kulmhof, the Aktion Reinhardt or Auschwitz-Birkenau camps, we realize one profound difference showing the uniqueness of the Arbeitsjuden in Kulmhof. Despite their inhumane and permanent deadly weekdays, they realized a normal everyday life in the little rural village. Of course, we know that a little rural site that has to house about 100 perpetrators whose job is to gas 1,000 Jews each day could not lead a peaceful or a normal life. But in the Jews' perspective, and they saw it and they were seen, Poles sold vegetables and bread to each other and the Germans, and sometimes it was the Jews who came up for picking up the goods in their chains. During the first 6 months in 1942, the ethnic German pupils went to school only 100 meters away from the yard, and they remembered the Jews in chains, as we know it from confessions in 1945. So the Jews' hell bordered the vicinity's normality in a very direct and visible way. And when we remember the wire netting fence around the mansion yard and the Graner house in 1944, so in the second period, we have to state that collecting, stocking, and repairing was a public scene, visible for everyone. So normality was within one's reach, but we do not know how many Jews tried to escape. But what we know is that on the 22nd of January in 1942, the Gestapo in Hohensalza wrote to the administrative district office, Landratsamt, of Hermannsbad, that three Jews fled on the occasion of a Judenaktion and sought for help to capture them. The names were Abraham Boy, 21 years of age, from Mühlenthal or Isbica, Milnak Bayer, 41 years from Litzmannstadt, and Abraham Tauber, 29 years old, from Litzmannstadt too. Abraham Boy was indeed Abraham Roy, who escaped as a grave digger from the Waldkommando on January the 16th and fled to Krosniewice or Kroswitz in German, where he informed some representatives of the Jewish community. One effect of that was a postcard from Rosa Kaplan to her husband in the Warsaw ghetto, in which she informed him about what an escapee from Kulmhof had reported. We know nothing about Milnak Bayer and Abraham Tauber, and maybe they didn't escape from Kulmhof, but fled from another so-called Judenlager, a Jewish working camp. But 3 days after Roy's successful escape, Michael Potlebnik from Kolo and Schlamer Wiener fled from the transport back from the Waldkommando to the mansion, took different ways, and met again in Grabow, where they informed the Rabbi Schulman, who wrote some letters spreading the shocking news. Abraham Roy took his way to Starachowice, was deported to Auschwitz in July 1944, from where he escaped later and was liberated by Russian soldiers. Schlamer Wiener went to Piotrków Trybunalski, and from there to the Warsaw ghetto using the name Jakub Grojnowski, where he was interviewed several times by Hirsch Wasser from the Onyx Shabbat archive. His testimonies became well known as Slamik's Report and were used in underground newspapers, reports to the Polish government in exile, and at least international newspapers. Szlama Wiener left Warsaw Ghetto to Zamość to see his sisters, and he was deported from there to Belzec in April 1942. Michal Podlepnik went to the ghetto of Rzeszów, Reichshof, but left again to hide in a farm for some months and was liberated in late 1944. All of them tried their best to inform the Jews about Kulmhof extermination camp and gave detailed information of historical uniqueness. On May the 16th in 1942, the Gestapo Leitstelle, the major branch of the Gestapo in Posen, informed all police departments in Wartegau about an escape of six Jews from the Sonderkommando Kulmhof during the last night, but we know from a post-war testimony of a fiancée of a German order policeman that shortly after, four of them were captured and shot. The fate of the two others remain unknown till today. These two German documentation-based examples can be completed with the story of two successful escapes in 1944. The 13-year-old Simon Srebnik arrived from Litzmannstadt Ghetto in March 1944 as one of the first Arbeitsjuden transport, and he managed with the help of a German policeman to survive the whole second period of Kulmhof as a member of the now so-called Hauskommando, the former Schlosskommando. Mordechai Zurawski was deported from Litzmannstadt Ghetto in July 1944 and came to the Waldkommando. On January the 17th in 1945, when the Red Army arrived at Litzmannstadt, all 47 remaining Jews in the granary should be shot. Simon Srebnik indeed was shot, but in his neck, and the bullet came out of his mouth. When lying on the ground, Srebnik realized his situation and waited for the next shootings. After he escaped, wearing only his underwear, Zurawski himself had organized a knife from the kitchen in the granary house, as this was his last duty after all others from the Waldkommando had been shot. He used a short confusion after he left the room for being shot to flee and run. He escaped to a nearby village named Ostruf, where he hid in a barn until the Red Army arrived. Srebnik, Zurawski, and Podlepnik gave detailed information in summer 1945, when the Polish judge Wacisław Bednarz started his crime scene investigation. They testified at the Eichmann trial in Jerusalem and were interviewed by Claude Lanzmann for the Shoah movie. But besides their central historical information, there are other sources from the so-called Arbeitsjuden. Single sheets of paper were found after the war with last greetings and further information. Dated April the 2nd in 1943, when the slave laborers knew their fate because of the camps closing down, they hid a note, and I quote, "This note is written by people who will live for only a few more hours. The person who will read this note will hardly be able to believe that this is true. Still, this is the tragic truth, since in this place our brothers and sisters stayed, and they too died the same death. The name of this locality is Kowo. At a distance of 12 kilometers from this town, there is a slaughterhouse for human beings. We have worked there as craftsmen because among them there were tailors, leather stitchers, cobblers, and so on. There are 17 craftsmen here, and I can give you the names." Then you can see, follow the names. And the document ends, and I quote, "These are then the persons' names which I give here. These are only a few people from among the hundreds of thousands who died there. Shmuel Krakowski and Ilya Altman published one document in the Yad Vashem studies in 1991 as a testament of the last prisoners of the Chelmno death camp. And although we do not know anything about the possibility of writing and the circumstances of finding the notebook of 17 sheets, it is still very expressive. It was found only in a Russian transcript submitted to the Moscow Anti-Fascist Jewish Committee, dated the 10th of March in 1945, and is now located in the Moscow Central Archive. It must have been written after September the 21st, as one of the writers, Berek Sittenfeld, dated his own entry that day. 15 Jews wrote down their personal experience, their hometown and origin, and asked for making all the contact public, for informing relatives abroad, and to take revenge on the Germans. Therefore, they documented 28 phonetic names of German perpetrators, as well as Hans Bodmann's private address in Poznan. For tens of years, the literature on Kulmhof extermination camp has been meager. Publications by Vyacheslav Bednarz in 1946, Edward Savansky in 1964, and Janusz Gulczynski in 1991 presented a lot of first-hand information. But because published in Polish, the subject stayed a forgotten site, as Manfred Struck entitled a little German compilation of historical sources to Kulmhof in 2001. But a second view may show that the situation has not been so bad. There are books like Chelmno Witnesses Speak by Vucia Pawlicka-Nowak from the District Museum in Konin, which is a very good collection of eyewitness accounts, and Ruta Sarkowska's study in German, Die zweite Etappe ist der Tod. A leap in research quality because of the contextualizing of Kulmhof into the final solution in Poland has been the study of Shmuel Krakowski in 2007, published in German and English. But let me say that finally this murderous site has found an historian who made the most important contribution last year, some months ago. The study Chelmno and the Holocaust by Patrick Montague presents all aspects of this first extermination camp, including a lot of new information on the so-called Arbeitsjuden. Thank you.